Southampton. Welcome everyone. My name's Adam from New Forest Physiotherapy Clinic. The vast majority of you know me, but there are a few unfamiliar faces, so that's who I am. So my name's Adam. I'm a physiotherapist at New Forest Physiotherapy Clinic. We have a clinic that's just, you can see us literally, if you go out the door, we're in the Southern Business Centre, a big centre just as you look to your left as you go out the gate. And we've been in there since 2012, we started there. So the timetable for tonight is a quick introduction by myself. I'll tell you the story of the clinic. I'm afraid you're going to have to hear that. We've then got Duncan from CrossFit Solent. He's going to talk about keeping fit and functional movement for 10 minutes. Then nutritional advice from Sam from Lean Eaters for 10 minutes. We'll then take a 10-minute break. You can then recharge your cups, get some more teas, coffees, biscuits, help yourselves. Please, in that time, ask us any questions, any physio-related or nutrition or exercise-related questions. That's your opportunity to speak to us. And then the main event is Jamie, who will tell us his story, which is, it is an inspirational and quite an amazing story that he has to tell. I must confess, we were expecting more people. We have a lot more people on our list, so if anyone else turns up, we'll just let them come in and join us as we go. So, New Forest Physio Clinic, the idea was actually born when I was I'm an Army Reservist, and I thought of it whilst I was in Afghanistan back in February 2007. And the idea for the clinic was born out there. We opened up in Gangwarrily, which is down in Fawley, in September 2007. And then the second clinic, as I've already mentioned, opened up in the business centre just over here in June 2012. I need a time check. If I go beyond 25 minutes past, I'm going to stop me. So why did I form New Forest Physiotherapy Clinic? Well, I've worked in various different sectors. There's a few NHS workers in the room here. I've also worked in the private health sector, where I've worked for the military as well. And I found that working in the NHS, in the private health sector, could be quite restricting, particularly in the NHS, but also the private health sector. You could get people back functional. So you might get them back to work, but you couldn't get them back to full athletic ability. The funding just wasn't there for that. Whereas in the military, that was precisely your purpose, was to get people back to full athletic ability so that people could pass their basic fitness test, which one of the tests is an 8-mile march with a heavy rucksack, carrying a weapon. They have to do that in under 2 hours. So you've got to be of a good level of fitness. And I enjoyed doing that kind of physiotherapy. The facilities were always excellent, we had great gym facilities. And I decided when I was out in Afghanistan, start thinking what I'm going to do when I get back. That's what I decided I would do, is I would set up my own clinic, which had the ability to return people to full athletic ability. And I'm on that journey to this day, really. We're still growing as a business. We haven't quite got the full rehab gym yet, but at some point, that is the ultimate aim, is to have that kind of facility. I'd like to have something that mirrors somewhere like Hendon Court at some point, but that's not just available to military people. If I was speaking to Jamie actually earlier about the limitations of the NHS, the NHS will get you so far, but it fails in getting you back as far as perhaps you might like to go. It certainly doesn't get you back to full athletic ability. So that's why I set the clinic up back in 2007. For those of you who haven't been to us before, we do pride ourselves on getting people back to fitness. So our clinic guarantee is that we endeavour to return you to full athletic ability, whatever that might be for you. And we do have a 100% money back guarantee. If you're not entirely satisfied with the service that we give you, then we do give people their money back. Luckily, it's only happened twice, so that's good. And so if you're struggling with pain, if you're struggling with injury, then please do give us a call. In the break, you'll have the opportunity to speak to us, so please do so. Pilgrim Bandits is a military charity. We do support them. They take injured soldiers on rehabilitation expeditions throughout the world. They do things like take people up Kilimanjaro and various different locations. I know they did the in Norway, the Telemark expedition, taking injured soldiers on those sorts of expeditions. We have got a charity box. It is a local charity. They're not a particularly big charity. If you like what you hear tonight, and if some of you would like to support, then please just give us in our rattle box, which is outside, please just make a donation. That would be great. We'll come back to that. So I'm going to pass on, I'm well ahead of time, so I shall pass on to Sam. Sam's going to go first.
And the method that I use allows you to focus on that one thing, that one big piece as part of the puzzle, and just do that for 2 weeks really well, and then move on to the next piece and the next piece. The first main habit, it actually is writing down what you eat. Real common sense, sounds very simple, but you don't know what you don't know. And I don't necessarily mean counting calories or weighing food. I'm going to show you a method of portion control in a moment without counting calories. But this is actually a client of mine 6 weeks ago. This is her first food diary she did for a week. And obviously you can't read it from there, but I just circled the meals that we were going to focus on and put the next habit that I'm going to talk to you now about. But if you want to lose weight or improve your diet, simply writing down what you're eating for a week, 2 weeks. As I said, you've got that knowledge already, more knowledge than you think you have. You'll be able to start picking things out, making changes just by writing down what you're eating. So the first key habit that I use with all my clients is eating a portion of protein. So protein is fish, meat, dairy like yogurt, milk, cheese, and eggs. And that's the key habit that I use for fat loss. The main reason we do that is because it's filling. So if you're eating something filling at regular intervals throughout the day, you're feeling more full, you're less likely to snack, you're not feeling restricted. And the focus is on putting something positive into your diet rather than taking something negative out. So most diets focus on restriction or elimination, so taking out gluten or taking out dairy or cutting out carbs. My focus is always putting more good foods back into your diet, and that squishes out foods that you're trying to avoid. That's the first habit. The second habit is what I call the hand system. So this is the way that we use portion control without weighing food or counting calories. It's just using your hand, basically. So I thought I'd take you through this. So for protein, I said a portion of protein earlier. So a portion of protein for a woman is the size of your palm and the thickness of your palm. Okay, for a guy, it'd be twice the amount. Okay, so if you've written down your food diary for a week and you're looking at where you haven't got any protein, you can focus on trying to get protein into that meal like I showed you earlier with that food diary. And you would do that, just that one habit. Don't try and change anything else, just focus on that for 2 weeks or 3 weeks, 4 weeks, however long it takes you to do, until it becomes natural, until you're not having to use willpower to do so. Vegetables. So for vegetables, fist. One fist for a woman, two fists for a man at each meal. And this is the end point. This is not where you begin in, but this is where you want to get to. So having a portion of protein of each meal, size of your palm or two palms, or fist or two fists of vegetables with every meal. Carbohydrates, so bread, pasta, rice, fruit. For a female, is a cupped hand. For guys, two cupped hands. Yeah, so you're not having to do all stuff and portion things out, things like that. You can just do it by sight, looking down at your plate. It's very visual and very simple to do. And the last one, healthy fats. So olive oil, avocado, butter. One thumb for a female, two thumbs for a man. That's the two key habits. I've got some handouts with me today, which is a 4 weeks worth of food planners and a little miniature portion template guide. So I'll be out there later. If anyone wants to try this, they're more than welcome to take one of those away. And I'll talk you through it this evening if you want to do that. I have a guarantee with my coaching, guarantee with this, that if you follow those two steps for 4 to 6 weeks, and you don't improve your health or lose any body fat, I will coach you for 3 months. As well as my own guarantee, my own business. Any client that works with me and they're not entirely satisfied in the period that I work with them, I keep coaching them for free until they do. That hasn't happened yet. So please come and ask me about what I've spoken tonight or any other nutritional questions you want to ask. Thanks.
So, good evening guys, my name is Duncan. I'm just going to let this load up and I'm very excited about sharing what CrossFit is to you guys. So, first up, thank you for letting me come have a chat with you, everyone here tonight. I met Adam through Sam. Sam works out of CrossFit Southampton and one of our nutritionists, and all the best nutritionists. Adam came in and his own words saw the beast in people, which I guess. So, background, I've been a professional American football player, well, on and off, started in this country, went to Germany, moved around, went back to school, went to America, was in America for 5 years, and that's how I found out CrossFit. And I've been in the fitness industry for 16, 17 years now, and nothing has come close to the holistic approach of what CrossFit is. So this is the chance for me to... We've been running CrossFit Solon. I've been open for 3 years now. We are based over by IKEA. We have a 3,000 square foot unit there. We're currently looking at other premises to sort of bring in more of a holistic, so obviously having a unit for massage and so on and so forth, similar to business. So, I'm just going to talk to you a few things tonight about the importance of functional movement. First off, hands, show of hands. Anyone heard about CrossFit before? Has anyone heard of the term functional movement? Yeah, cool. Alright, so tonight we're just going to touch on functional movement. We're going to talk about mobility, flexibility, kind of things that we sort of preach, I say preach, but we try and get people to understand the importance of it. Alright, so I'm going to see if this works. I'm just going to show you a little video, alright? I think it's the best way to sort of get my point across rather than me standing here and talking to everyone too much. Let's see if this works.
Something extra that I need in life, I have that, and I'm coming into my passion. emotional. It doesn't look emotional. It looks like people working out, but it's emotional. I mean, it's raw. It's intense. It's incredible. It's freaking awesome. I'm gonna keep doing it for a long time. CrossFit to me is a fitness program where the reward for doing well is the ability to express your fitness in everyday life in as many different planes or as many different activities that you can possibly imagine.
People walk through the door and say, "Hey, where's all the machines? What are the machines?"
All right. So the biggest thing I wanted you guys to sort of get out of that is everyday life, okay? A lot of these regular gyms that we go to, all right, is putting us in a position that is sort of, you're right there, it's putting us into sort of close gaps. I want people to realize that what we do at a gym helps us outside, all right? Whatever we want to do, whether our friends call us up and say, "Oh, I want to go for a bike ride," and you feel like you are able to, you're not sort of second guessing yourself about fitness, all right? So, and what is CrossFit and why should we be doing it? I think, certainly with my experience in the fitness industry, CrossFit is the one thing that sort of encompasses everything. We go on a thing that I'll touch on in a sec, is the 10 elements of fitness, all right? So, within the 10 elements of fitness, all right, we look at stamina, we look at strength, we look at flexibility, we look at cardiovascular endurance, all right? We look at power, we look at speed, coordination, accuracy, agility, and balance, okay? Where in like a fitness regime comes everything. Every time you walk out your door, one of these things is touched on, okay? Driving, okay? Reaching for something, all right? If I get everyone to stand up, please. Okay. Alright. And then sit down. Okay. In the fitness world, alright, that is basically called a squat. Okay? But in fitness, we do it all the time. Okay? We're standing up, we're moving, alright? Things in like 101, the guy said, I walk into a CrossFit gym, where are all the machines? And like, that's the problem. I think a lot of people are starting to realize that they must be on a machine to work. Okay? I want people to try and change that mentality. I mean, you don't need machines to work out, okay? You're fine as you are, you just need to change the different levels of what you're doing. Okay, so 10 elements of fitness, alright? It's worth having a look at those, alright? And look at how are you hitting, okay? When you're talking about cardiovascular, alright, climbing the stairs, alright? Running for the bus, alright, the basic sort of movements and then coordination. Can you sort of open the door right? Can you move? Can you, if someone turns around and reach for something? Or all these sort of trains of movement. Alright. Okay. So I touched on a bit of the functional movement. I'm probably not going to show you another video because no. Okay, alright. Term I want you to look at is natural. Okay, it's a natural movement. If we look at a machine, for example, in a regular gym, okay, that we sit down and we're forced in a position that we have to move, okay? We're now obviously getting the support, but we're not allowing our body to develop the supportive muscles, all right? So things like push-ups, if I take the basic movement of the chest press, okay, chest press machine, all right? I'm getting the stability because I'm sat down and I'm supporting myself, but when in the world am I ever going to be sat in a machine doing this, okay? I'm not really going to be sort of using that. So we will take that same movement, either put you on the floor or even get you to stand up using a wall to get the same stimulus as the regular machine. Alright, so we can sort of adapt our training towards it. Alright. With that, I will share because I think it will get my point across a little better for you guys to understand it. Okay?
The official definition of CrossFit is constantly varied functional movements performed in high intensity. Functional movements are what prepare you for life. Squatting, running, jumping, throwing, pulling, picking things up all predate gyms by thousands of years. They weren't invented by anyone, and they're found everywhere. This is what our bodies were meant to do. It's part of our DNA. CrossFit workouts use functional movements because they're so much more effective for life outside the gym.
Okay, so that gives you some idea. When we talk about, thank you, functional movement. Alright, probably coming to my end, right? Okay. Mobility and flexibility. We have a lot of classes that involve flexibility and mobility. We will be introducing, I think, for the FMS, functional movement screening, to the box and getting you guys to the point of, all right, are you able to move correctly? And I think if I was to put you in a CrossFit class without testing these, I think I'll be doing you this justice, all right? These are some of the biggest things, mobility and flexibility, all right? That a lot of people sort of forget about. You know, do a workout, I've got 10 minutes, I'm going to stretch, I'll go, all right? So we'll teach you, because it's Kelly Starrett, uses a great term, every human being should know how to look after themselves or look after their body. Kelly Starrett is quite a big one in regards to mobility and flexibility within the CrossFit world. And we spend a lot of time teaching people how to look after themselves and giving them the tools. I must sort of reiterate that we are coaches, similar to what Sam says. We're not there to hold your hand as we go. We want to give you the tools, because we're not always going to be there outside of the world. We want to give you the tools to get there. All right. And finally, the community. Unlike anything you'll get in any regular gym, put your headphones in when you go to the gym, you won't look at anyone, you won't talk to anyone. We're in the business of helping people and making people better. And when you're in a group, it speaks for itself, all right? You go through, as the video said before, you go through the same things, so everyone is working together. We have a lot of events that involve the community. This is just one that we had recently. For all the women in the box. A box is a term that we also call the gym. They all come down and work out together, and it's a great community atmosphere. It's great fun. And I just want to thank them for letting me share CrossFit. And if you have any questions, I'm more than happy to share. We have open days and stuff, and like I said, we're based over by IK, if you're interested in popping down. Thanks, guys.
So, well, 10 minutes ahead of schedule, which is great. So, if you just recharge your drinks, and then we've got the main event, which is Jamie. So, take 10 minutes, have a drink on your reserves together. The last exercise together was in Kenya, I think, back in 2006. And then things happened for Jamie, which weren't really planned, but here he is today. So I shall pass you over to Jay.
Thanks very much, Adam. Yeah, if you kill the lights. Yeah, just so you've got a bit more resolution on the screen. The lighting's not great in here. I'll give you a little bit more resolution on the screen with my slides. And I apologise that I'm sort of partially sort of blacked out as a result, but hopefully you can all hear me.
Yes.
Okay, first of all then, ladies and gents, delighted to be here. As Adam mentioned, I was kindly invited along to speak to New Forest Physiotherapy 3 years ago now. And so Adam's business then was in its infancy. And I guess I was at a much earlier stage of my recovery. And I'd been through the mill, and I'd fortunately come through a catastrophic sort of life-changing event in my life. And very fortunately was able to go on and achieve a lot more thereafter with the right will and determination. So effectively what my presentation to you all tonight is all about is my journey, a little bit about my sort of former life and some of the bits and pieces that I got up to. It will indeed focus on a life-changing event, okay, and I'll come on to that. And from thereafter, I will talk to you about my long recovery process, coming through that, and following on from that, some of the bits and pieces that I managed to go on and achieve, as I mentioned, with the right will and determination, and some of the opportunities that I've been very fortunate to have. Okay. So this is a presentation about burn survival. Okay, which I was subject to a burns incident almost 8 years ago, the summer of 2007, August 19th, 2007. I put in a couple of earlier images, okay, because, I mean, you saw me at the beginning when we had the lights on, okay, when you walked into the hall. Probably one thing that struck you was, my God, you know, this guy has been through something, he's been through an ordeal in life. And clearly, you know, I picked up a lot of physical scarring from that, which is quite evident, it's quite graphic. People pick up on that. I meet young children in the doctor's surgery with their parents, and they look at me, and they sometimes, you know, they look at me and they look away. Sometimes I even hear them whispering to their mother, "Mummy, what happened to that man?" And occasionally, you know, if they're close enough, I might volunteer the information and actually tell the child what I've been through. You know, so it's changed my life in a lot of ways, not just the visual appearance, but also how other people view me and how other people perceive that image. And that's something, another aspect of my specific injury that I had to come to terms with. I was in my sort of former life, as I call it, because when I was injured with massive burns, which I will come on to, before that, I did a few different things in life. I'd actually been an international expedition leader and specifically worked in marine scuba diving expeditions overseas. I was a frontline police officer also in the Thames Valley, and I used to basically respond to 999s and run around predominantly like a headless chicken, day shifts, night shifts, and all the rest of it. Also, in my life at that time, and Adam's already mentioned it, I was also an army reservist, and I trained as a paratrooper throughout the years 2003-2004, and then I was actively in a unit with the British Army Reserves for 5 years. And during that time, I was a man, a young man, still in my prime, and I was driven by the prospect of challenge and adventure. And that's why I signed up to volunteer as an Army Reservist. And there was the thrill of the challenge and adventure, and this one particular shot was taken of me, and Adam already mentioned it, we were on exercise together out in Kenya, at the time out in the bush in Kenya, in northern Kenya, so this was me seeking that challenge, seeking that adventure, in the prime of my life, and still only about 30-31 years of age, and just going forth in life as I was. Physically speaking, and mentally also, but physically I was at the top of my game, and thanks to the army and the training that I received as a paratrooper, I was an extremely fit, motivated and determined individual. I had that real lust for life, and I was kind of going with those opportunities, and I was moving forward in life in that respect. Mentally, I was very focused, extremely determined. I kind of knew what I wanted, and again, I was following my ambition. And I think that's kind of what was important to mention about those sort of former days. Just a couple of shots just to highlight some of the bits and pieces. And also, this is not so much of a vanity thing, me showing you these earlier shots of me. It's just so you get an idea of the actual level of transformation that I had through the burns injury, okay, which I'm coming on to. Again, the challenge and adventure, the Army Reserves was a significant part of my life for those 5 years. And with the unit, I managed to have some great opportunities trained in different parts of the world. And again, that was the challenge and that was the adventure for me. This one, incidentally, was in Sweden in some very cold temperatures, but we had some fun and challenging times up there. Ooh. I should have one of those little clickers, guys. Sorry, butter fingers. Okay, sorry, another one in the cold. And just some of the action adventure. Again, it's just more in terms of showing you a bit of transformation. That one, I suppose, is better. Here I had, I suppose, the old me, one of the latter shots just before I was injured, and I just turned 32 years of age. So I had a pretty significant hair loss. That was a bit of a bitter pill to swallow. But I liken myself to the fact that I'm maybe still good enough for government work. I had, around about that time in my life, 32 years of age, I had a personal lifelong ambition. I wanted to learn to fly. In this respect, I was influenced by my late grandfather. He had been a pilot in the Second World War, and he qualified just towards the end of the Second World War and flew Hurricane aircraft, fighters, single-engine fighters, and qualified just at the end of the war. And when I was a young boy, he used to tell me many stories. He only qualified at the end of the war, but you know, he'd flown the aircraft, he would tell me all about the aircraft. There was the inspiration, and it was something that I wanted to do. So in typical sort of myself or me fashion, I decided to kind of put my ambitions or my money where my mouth was, so to speak, and I decided to embark upon a new adventure. I went to the States, and I've had this passion to follow my dream, to learn to fly. I think it was probably safe to say at the age of 32 then, at that time of my life, I wasn't going to get to those dizzy heights. Having had, you know, this was the first sort of step that I'd embarked upon trying to realise that dream of learning to fly. But I was in Florida, and I was inspired by, wanting to see what was going on. So I got the opportunity to visit NASA and have a look around as a tourist. But interestingly enough, I got to see the very final shuttle launch. A Challenger went up in the summer of 2007. It was in mid-August, and it was that was a fantastic inspiration for me to see that actually going up. I stood 10 miles back and I saw Challenger going off, and I saw those big sort of rocket propulsion boosters, you know, with all the fire trail behind, shooting up into the stratosphere and then some. Obviously up into outer space, and it was a once in a lifetime moment for me. Okay, and I was in the right place at the right time. I got my dream, and I went. I went to fly in an academy over there, and I flew a single engine piston. I learned to fly a single engine piston solo. And it was a Liberty manufactured aircraft, Liberty Aerospace. Call sign, as you can see, November 550 X-ray Lima. And I flew within a small municipal aerodrome, or small airport, in the Daytona Beach area of Florida, not that far away from Daytona itself. Okay, and it was, as I said, this was a dream. It was something that I'd sort of worked towards. It's quite an expensive game, as probably most people could respect in that sense. But it was a dream, something I'd worked towards, and I finally got that dream was starting to come to fruition. Just a little shot of the internal aspects of the aircraft, and you'll see left seat, right seat. Okay, left seat was the seat that I was using as the pilot in command. Just a couple of distant shots of the aircraft and just taxiing. You can see me sort of taxiing there with the aircraft out on the airstrip. And just a little one of airborne. Cast your mind back to what I said a moment ago. And when I said to you, I was at the right place at the right time. And I went to NASA and I went to see that shuttle launch. And it was kind of like a, you know, kind of dream come true to see the shuttle launch. That was the right place at the right time. However, on this one particular day, and I mentioned the day already, it was the 19th of August 2007. I remember it so fittingly, and I remember it so well, because I figuratively class it as my second birthday, a little bit like the Queen. But in my respect, it was like that I was born again, okay, as a result of what happened on that day. Now, never in all my days did I think I would be subject to what happened next. So I'd been flying up until this day for 3 weeks or so. The first 2 weeks I was under instruction with several instructors, one-to-one. Okay, they would take the right seat, I would take the left seat that you saw in the image, and we'd fly. And I would fly up and I would practice takeoffs, landings, flying in the pattern, flying between small municipal airports and landing and then coming back again. And on this one particular day, I got into a spot of bother. I took off solo. By this stage I was solo. I'd been flying solo for about 8 days. And I was very near completion of the airtime that I needed, the hours, and logging those hours. And just had a couple more hours to do, get a quick check flight with one of the ground examiners. And then I would have been coming home, back to the UK. In actual fact, I was due to go with my team in the Army Reserves. I was due to go out to Afghanistan that autumn. I'd been given the nod actually before I went to America to say, there's a date for you and you're part of a team and you're going to Afghanistan as a volunteer reservist. And I was all set for that. However, on this one particular day of my flying and during flight, I was subject to being forced into a position where I actually had to call a hasty mayday on descent. So I'd taken off on this day, I'd flown from one airport to another, landed, taken off again, I'd come back into the original aerodrome airspace, joined the pattern, and as I joined the pattern and then came across, or downwind, then crosswind, in towards setting myself up for a landing, my engine combusted at 1,000 feet indicated altitude above the ground, and I veered around, I came in towards my approach for the runway, and as I'm coming in and dropping and descending in height, in altitude, the fire in the aircraft breached the cockpit internally. Okay, so remember that image of the cockpit internally? So I was sat in the left-hand seat, and the fire started to encroach the front aspect of the cockpit down where it was in the footwell area. My feet started to burn where the fire came in, and it started to work its way up my legs. I'm only wearing a pair of shorts to the knee, because it's extremely hot in Florida at that time of year. So I'm wearing a pair of shorts, I'm wearing a t-shirt, and I'm wearing pair of shoes and socks, and a pair of sunglasses as well, because of the sunshine. As I'm bringing the aircraft down, I'm burning more. Okay, as the time elapses and the seconds tick on, I'm burning more, and the fire builds up and up and up. As I near the ground, I'm probably a couple of hundred feet above the deck, above the ground indicated, and I can also make that visual judgment through the window and as I see the ground ahead of me. And the fire builds up, it's sort of around the chest area, and it's starting to go up towards the head. Now I realise at this point that my situation is not looking good. Not least because I'm actually on fire, and where the fire is. But it was a sort of a time judgment, if you like, a time analysis. And to me, it was pretty obvious. I'd been burning for X amount of time. Maybe 20 seconds or so, and the fire was already starting to enrage, and it was getting bigger in there, it was getting hotter. And so I realised I'm in a real spot of bother, and I'm not sure quite what to do at this stage. And so there was a little bit of mild panic that set in initially, and I thought, Christ, how am I going to deal with this? You know, am I going to be able to land this aircraft and roll in? Physically land on the concrete, on the threshold of the runway, roll into a full stop, halt and stop, and then physically extricate myself and climb out of the aircraft, opening the door. And I realised, based on the amount of time that I'd been burning, it was pretty obvious to me, it was a bit of a no-brainer. And I thought, no, the fire's up here, and it's starting to sort of lick around my chops, as it were, the flames are starting to lap around my face. And I thought, you know what, I need to do something drastic. Really drastic, otherwise I'm not going to make it. Simple as. So, as I said, I put in a hasty mayday, and I felt if I didn't do something very hasty, I wasn't going to get out of there. So I chose to veer, to pull my nose up on the descent, and veer away from the concrete of the runway, and glided, to put the aircraft into a glide, after shutting the engine, instrumentation and controls and fuel pump. So it was a sequence that I'd been taught, you know, ignition, alpha, bravo, magnetos, off, off, master switch, off, lights, off, strobes, off, fuel pump, off, fuel selector valve, rotate, off, everything off, 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 in sequence. As I'd been taught, it stayed with me. So I thought, I've got to do this. Everything off, put the aircraft into glide, veer away, over the grass, My flaps were on, so I'm slowing my speed and my speed on the approach, but I'm slowing quite rapidly here, okay? I need to then do something even more drastic. And this, I think, harps back to, quite honestly, the benefits that I probably received from my former life. Perhaps running around all those 999s and dealing with all those emergency situations and having to think hastily and having to make sort of snap judgments. And also, I would also add, the detailed and protracted and repetitive training that I'd had with the army as well. As a paratrooper, I was very fortunate to receive some very high quality training from the RAF in parachuting, and effectively I was very well versed in having the confidence to jump from a moving object. So that training sort of kicked in, the confidence to make this hasty decision kicked in. I thought, I've got to get out. I've got to get out of this aircraft, I'm on fire. I've got to get out. So after shutting all the engine instrumentation and control and the fuel pump off, I managed to remove headset, toss that into the opposite right-hand footwell, undo the harness, which was a bit more intricate than your standard harness in the passenger airline. It's a sort of a three-point harness that pilots will wear up front to give you a bit more kind of added stability and protection. I managed to undo that without sort of panicking too much. Open the canopy door to my left, and that flipped up to the vertical position. I then sort of tweaked the control stick to make sure that the approach, the angle of my approach was good, and that the wings were straight and level, but the nose was a tad heavy to keep the glide on, to keep the airflow sort of through the wing, as it were. Keep that glide on and keep a little bit of airspeed on. Got out onto the left wing, and then in the good old fashioned parachute exit fashion, I managed to literally compose myself on the wing and make a big jump. Okay. Again, thankful to my former military training. It was almost as if all the training that I'd done in those 5 years of sweat and toil paid off for that one moment in my life. I managed to make the jump, I managed to execute the jump safely, but the aircraft was moving at about 30 knots, about 35 miles per hour, and I was about an estimated 15 feet above the ground when I physically jumped from the rear of the left wing. Okay, so the trailing edge, the rear of that left wing. So 15 feet above ground, 30 knots, about 35 miles per hour. Now there's a lot of force, and that's not going to dissipate and just go away. So that force will travel through the body. And when I hit the ground, admittedly, from that speed, at that height, there was a great kinetic energy there, and I landed, figuratively, like a sack of spuds. And I hit the ground, and I tried to roll it out in a method that I'd been taught time and time again, going back to my training in parachute landing. I tried to roll it out, but it was extremely sloppy. And I kind of came down on my knees, I then thrust forward, the angle was a bit wrong, I thrust forward, and I had a secondary impact, face versus ground. Little did I realise at that point, in that exact moment in my life, that I just sustained a critical injury, number one, life-threatening critical injury. Number two, that my life was never going to be the same again. Okay, in terms of medical diagnosis, okay, and which I will just come on to, but I rolled around in the dirt and the grass and smothered the flames. When I stopped and I paused, my right shoulder was still on fire and my right scalp was still on fire. And I waited and I curled up into a ball on the ground, scared stiff, because I knew where the aircraft was heading. The aircraft itself landed around 70 feet away from me, not far. Okay, there was an ugly crunch noise as it piled into the ground, and the prop, having been spinning at several thousand RPM, embedded itself in the earth ahead of me. So there's a terrific noise, which I won't forget. Subsequently, there was a pause, and then there was this almighty explosion. And I can only describe it to you all as a kind of a Hollywood-style explosion. The aircraft landed 70 feet away from me and subsequently exploded into a massive fireball. And this was taken just minutes into the aftermath by somebody that came, effectively heard the explosion and came out of the building and came running across and captured the moment on camera. Okay. Meanwhile, I was just out of shot here, around 70 feet away, having been subject to the blast, having been subject to the shock wave, and subject to the sheer heat and inferno that lay there just ahead of me. And that was the result for the aircraft itself. So something that I'd very narrowly avoided. That would have been the main gas tank, incidentally, that went up, and I do know for a fact that main gas tank had 100 litres, precisely 100 kilograms of low lead blue, high octane aviation fuel in the tank. So the fire found the fuel feed to the tank, to the engine, and subsequently ignited, and it's very explosive, and it went up in a 1 hour with that explosion. Just a shot from afar. And you can see the runway in the sort of rear ground, which I would have naturally taken had I not been on fire. Now, I guess really why I'm here, and especially in terms of clients regarding New Forest Physio and the physios themselves, is to tell you a little bit about how my life developed thereafter. And as I've said before, it was indeed, unfortunately for me, it was a life-changing accident. So everything I knew about me in the former life, about my life as an army reservist, about my life as a frontline police officer, about my life as a challenging adventurer, as it were, was gone. And I never knew at that stage, I didn't think that those days would ever be back. Okay. In terms of medical diagnosis, which I said that I'd mention, I was 60% third degree burn. So I think it was a good decision getting out onto that wing and actually jumping when I did. 60%. Also, in the action of jumping, remember I talked about the kinetic energy from the force of the jump. That caused me to inadvertently rupture the large intestine, the colon, and also lacerated one aspect of my liver internally from the jump. The impact that I mentioned, face versus ground, I had a bilateral nasal fracture, okay, with the impact. I fractured the left supraorbital eye socket here, just above the left eye. Okay, I had soft tissue laceration right the way through the tissue on the right side of the nose, they call it the alar, down through the lip. Okay, that was kind of wide open. And multiple facial soft tissue lacerations from being sort of torn up by the grass and sort of shredded. The grass at that part of the world, many of you probably are aware, it's like razor blades in America, a lot of the grass. I know we've got an American footballer over here, so he probably knows more about it than I do. Okay, but it was very sharp and it tore my face up and required a lot of reconstructive surgery. But what I wanted to mention, in terms of life-changing injury, I was airlifted, I was taken to a premier trauma hospital facility downtown in Orlando, downtown Florida. I received round the clock, 24/7, premier private medical care in the US for the next 6 months of my life. I have no, as in I have zero conscious recollection of what I went through. In fact, the medics are so good in terms of how they deal with trauma, they slipped me into a drug-induced coma for those 6 months, and I didn't have a clue what was going on. I mean, they were working with me, and undeniably, undoubtedly, I would have had a team of physios working round the clock, keeping my mobility up, and I would have had many different medical specialists coming in and out. I had one lead nurse who was my clinician, and everybody went through that woman. She had a clipboard and signed everybody in and out, and she took charge. And all the doctors, all the nurses, all the physios, all the specialists, all the radiologists and the x-ray people helped me along the way for 6 months. And that was my life, although, as mentioned, no conscious recollection whatsoever. Okay, and that was the life-changing aspect for me. So I went from being a young man full of challenge, you know, this drive towards challenge and adventure, and the goals and ambition, to being drug-induced coma for 6 months of my life, unaware of what was going on. In fact, effectively losing those 6 months of my life because of being unaware. Eventually, I was repatriated back to the UK, having been sort of mostly reconstructed, but still needed a lot of work. But I was deemed to be non-critical anymore, safe to transport. So they transported me back to the UK on a medically converted Learjet, I believe it was, back to Chelmsford in Essex. And I went to the Central Burns Unit in Chelmsford in Essex. And as far as I was concerned, still didn't know anything about it. I don't even remember the flight coming back home. I'm still in a drug-induced coma. I was reconstructed in America at a cost of $2.5 million, believe it or not. And I guess what price, you know, can you put on a human life? But fortunately, I think the moral of that side of the story is you wouldn't want to do anything remotely risky in America without insurance. Mm-hmm. When I got back to Chelmsford, as I said, the drug-induced coma continued. Okay, little did I know. But after about 6 weeks, I got woken up. And admittedly, I was struggling to come to terms with this because when I got woken up, a female English voice, maybe with an Essex accent, not that I've got anything against the Essex, but because of the area, Chelmsford, an Essex accent, a nurse spoke to me and said, "You know, Jamie, hi, you know, how are you doing this morning," kind of thing. And I'm like, my first response was, "Where's my American nurse?" All I remembered was one female American voice. I have no visual, conscious memory or recollection from America whatsoever. But I remember a female, it was like a love-hate relationship. Okay, and I remember this female American voice, and she would have been my lead nurse, because she was with me all the time. And I said, "Where's my American nurse?" And the Chelmsford nurse turned around and said, "You're not in America anymore, Jamie. You're with us in Chelmsford, in Essex." And I'm kind of like, oh my God, you know, the confusion was just manic. I couldn't grasp this. You know, I'd been in drug-induced coma for all those months of my life, and suddenly I'm being woken up, I'm being roused from this drug-induced coma. I'm having to wake up to the reality of, well, I'm not in America, I'm in England. You know, what's happened? And then it all dawned on me what had happened. I remembered everything, and it all came back to me. Now, I smashed the face, but I didn't have what they call traumatic brain injury, so I wasn't brain impaired, very fortunately. And very lucky in that respect. But so much more work needed to be done in Chelmsford. In fact, the long and the short of it was, in terms of the medical, I went on to receive in Chelmsford and also in Stoke Mandeville for the next 15 months of my life on a step down sort of regular burns unit. 15 months in Stoke Mandeville, 1 month in East Grinstead Hospital in Surrey, around about 1 month in High Wycombe, and then latterly I went to Cambridge for some more plastic surgery, more sort of aesthetic sort of finish with my plastic surgeon at Adam Brooks in Cambridge. 58 operations later, I reached a decision in life, and I said to myself and the surgeons, I said, "You know what? I'm done. I can't do any more of this. In fact, I'm happy where I am. I'm satisfied. You know, I don't like what's happened to me, but I'm going to just crack on with life now, and I'm going to accept who I am." And in all honesty, the reason why I worked with the surgeons, we worked together to reconstruct me and all the rest of it. And those 58 operations, hands on heart, I can say I needed that help. I needed them to do what they did for me, to pull me back out of the gutter. Okay, I had abdominal reconstruction, right elbow reconstruction, facial reconstruction in terms of sort of what they call maxillofacial. I had some nose work done, some work on the eye socket. I had soft tissue reconstruction over 60% of my body, because it was 60% third degree burn. I've had pig skin, I've had human donor skin, I've had synthetic skin, I've had my own skin. I learned that, an interesting fact, many of you, the medics may know here, but many of you may not know, you cannot give another person your skin and for them to have permanent cover. Do you get that? So when I sustained the burn rather, I could have phoned up my old mate Adam and said, Adam, I'm in a bit of bother here, I need a bit of skin. Adam would have said, yeah, you're a great mate and I'm prepared to give you a little shaving off my backside or whatever. My wife probably won't even bat an eyelid. Okay. However, Adam would only give me cover for about 7 days. And then my body, because the DNA matches is off kilter, it's not the same, my body will reject Adam's skin. But what the human donor skin can do, or the synthetic skin, or the pig skin, will give you that temporary cover on the wounds, okay, where your body's really, really struggling to heal and come back. It's third degree burn. It runs deep and it damages all the layers, all the fat tissue and everything. Okay, so in terms of that example, Adam's skin, 7 days of cover, my body will reject it. It will effectively start to biodegrade on me if I used Adam's skin. My body would say, thank you, but no thanks, I don't want that, because it doesn't match. The only skin that will give me permanent cover, long term, and get me on the road to healing, is my own skin. So they harvested aspects of my body. They harvested the thighs, the buttocks, parts of the abdominal that were kind of salvageable, areas that were kind of clean that they could use. But as I said, I was 60% third degree burn. That left the surgeons with an epic task. This guy's got 60% burn, he's only got 40% good skin left, 40% viable skin that we can use to reconstruct the guy. So they use very clever processes. They take a shaving, they punch holes in it, like a tea bag. And because skin is stretchy, they can stretch it out. Okay, perforate the skin, stretch it out, and they can get better cover. So effectively, they were trying to shave off areas and stretch it out and give me the cover back again. But not all of it takes, some of it fails, and it's a nightmare roller coaster. That is why it took me 2 years of inpatient time in the hospital. I was effectively living in hospital, or a multitude of hospitals between US, Chelmsford and Stoke Mandeville, for 2 years of my life. I was then an outpatient for a further 4 years, until the 58 operations were complete. I was effectively healed. I'd had the other aspects of my body, the orthopedic bits, kind of tweak the elbow, abdominal section, so on. And so it gave me core function, and I could effectively turn around and make that decision and say to the surgeon, you know what, I'm done. I'm happy. I can't stomach general anaesthetics anymore. I don't want you to keep knocking me out. And I just want to try and get on with the rest of my life and just keep going, keep moving forward. So it was a big decision to make, okay, and a massive ordeal, hence why I said at the beginning, definitely life changing. Now, I'm just putting these in quickly to show you where I was at, okay. This is a bit hard hitting. I don't always do this for audiences, okay, but because you're quite a small sort of select group, and probably have a partial interest in the medical side of things, hence your interest in New Forest Physio. I just want to highlight and make a point of where I was. And I think you can all appreciate how much of a fight back that is. Okay, and that is again why it took me 2 to 3 years or 3 years of my life effectively to heal and get over the worst. That was in Florida, by the way. The images speak for themselves. I was highly dependent. I was fed through a nasogastric yellow tube into the stomach 24/7. I was ventilated through through the trachea for my lungs in the neck there. I didn't know what was going on. It's just as well, ladies and gents. Now this is a little bit fast forward. This would have been around about a year and a half later. And you can see what I'm still up against. Massive areas of my body obliterated from burn. And trying to get that skin cover that I talked about, the pig skin, the human donor skin, the short-term cover, because they couldn't keep grafting me. They can only graft the same areas about three times incidentally. They can only re-harvest those areas, and the quality of skin will decline, and it's no good any longer. So massive ordeal, 18, 20 months down the road, I'm still facing all this. Much pain and suffering. It speaks for itself. My journey to recovery, 3 years. I mentioned at the beginning the words will and determination. Okay? I had all those years, okay, to fight. All those years to psychologically suck it in, keep my chin up, as it were, and try and look towards the future. And it is, I appreciate, you know, that for anybody that's that comes through injury, not an easy thing to do. It really, really not an easy thing to do. When the chips are down so desperately in one's life, to keep that level of motivation, to keep that level of motivation high. And as much as I talk about that internal kind of journey, physically, pain and suffering, psychologically, trying to keep your morale up, your self-esteem up every day, trying to motivate oneself under such desperate times and desperate circumstances. But I have to say, it was a team effort. And I couldn't have done it without, obviously, the doctors, the surgeons, the nurses. I had an awful lot of physiotherapy. Okay, so when I was in Chelmsford, in Essex, they woke me up from that drug-induced coma. I could not, I could not do anything. I'd been laid on my back for 6 months or more. Okay, as you see in the images, ventilated, fed. So when I woke up and when they roused me from the coma, first of all, I had to kind of get a grip on the reality, where I was, and how it all was for me. Next, I had to start to function as a normal human being once again. I effectively had to learn to walk from scratch. I couldn't walk. I'd had significant damage to my lower limbs, and in particular the frontal portion of both shoulders. The surgeons in America were obligated, really, and forced to strip out large sections of shin muscle. And for physios, tibialis anterior, I pretty much lost all of tibialis anterior, and the deep peroneal nerve that runs through that and controls the foot up lift. So I lost, effectively, the ability to raise my foot up, okay, which all of us normally take for granted, and they call that dorsiflexion. Okay, I have some plantar, and I have limited inversion and eversion, and a little bit of plantar going down, not much, but it's kind of good enough for a sort of a reasonable function, but absolutely zero dorsiflexion, because I lost the shin muscle, I lost that deep peroneal nerve. So that rendered me with lower limb lifelong disability. Okay, and again, something that I had to come to terms with. Not only was I burned, but I now found myself as being a disabled human being and having to come to terms with that significant mobility impairment. So needless to say, the road to recovery through physiotherapy was massive. And I had a team of physios. At first, I remember two strapping great lads coming in with a harness, and they put this harness around there. This was after I'd sort of learned to sit up in bed, first of all. That took about 2 weeks. And I got out of bed, slowly but surely. Two strapping great physios came in and said, right, we've got to put this harness on you. I'm kind of like, you know, what the, you know, beaming hell's that, I think. And they said, yeah, we've got to get this on you because you'll need the support. They put this harness on me, and it was like a baby walker. And I'm having to sort of start from scratch and learn to walk because my muscles had gone, the nerve had gone, I had what they call bilateral foot drop, and it was an epic task in learning to walk, okay? And it took me weeks and weeks and weeks in Chelmsford just to kind of get those early first steps. It was kind of like being a toddler all over again, okay, just trying to come to terms with that and trying to figure it all out. I had to learn to feed. Remember, I'd been fed through a tube into the stomach. Now I had to learn to feed, but my right arm was locked out because of something called a heterotopic ossification or a myositis in the right elbow. So the bone kind of calcified because the soft tissue damage was from the fire was quite extreme, and my bone locked out. So later I had extensive orthopedic surgery to release that right elbow, get it moving again. But my right arm was locked out, which was a bit of a drama for me because I couldn't feed. Okay, and I was a right-handed man, you know, I was used to feeding with the right hand. So I had to learn to feed with the left. And it's quite tough actually when you're not used to spoon feeding with the left hand. I had to learn to write my name and do all the, you know, brush my teeth with the left hand and all those basics, the fundamental basic that we all take for granted. For me, it was self-physio, but I had an awful lot of, you know, physio in terms of, you know, learning to walk, learning to get mobile again, learning to sort of develop that core function. As I progressed in Chelmsford, they put me in a wheelchair, they took me down to the gym. You see those two beam things? A bit like gymnast tubes, and they put you on those and starting to sort of do it without the baby harness, and I'm trying to do it by myself. And I remember those early days thinking, oh my God, is this how I've got to spend the rest of my days? But I thought, you know what, I've got to try, I've got to push, because it was better than the alternative, which was to stay sat in the wheelchair that they were pushing me around in. This image basically depicts, obviously, the aftermath of the scarring in terms of the healing. This was taken by a photographer that managed to persuade me to take a shot. He wanted to kind of capture, I guess, from an aesthetic angle from the photographer's perspective, but also I think it's good in highlighting the sheer level of skin damage overall that my body sustained from the 60% third degree burns in, so upper body. Strangely enough, this got entered into the National Portrait Gallery in London, very bizarrely. I put this in just to show you the seasons. Again, it highlights the long and the arduous recovery process through burns. Okay, if you look closely, you can still see that I've got head dressing on. Okay, the scalp was still healing. A couple of years down the road, I'm walking, but I require that walking stick. You know, it took me a long time to redevelop the lower limbs and get the strength and the endurance back into the limbs that I needed for that everyday core function that we all take for granted. Things got better over time. Okay, I set myself goals. I guess it went back to the former me. You know, you used to grab those goals. You know, I wanted to achieve. I wanted to kind of go a little bit further in life. Okay, so I set myself goals. And I used every day I'd push myself and I'd get out. I learned initially to walk around the block. This is how my take on, this is my analogy. I learned to walk around the block eventually on the ward, and then around the block in the hospital. And effectively, I pushed the boundaries on that block, and the block got bigger in my mind. And I would challenge myself to push that block and the dimensions of that block to walk further. And I was, in doing so, I would promote my, a number of things actually. I would promote my recovery through stamina, endurance, promote my appetite, therefore eat more, therefore encourage my skin and my soft tissue to heal more, and the musculature that had been damaged from the original burn. And again, I walked and walked and walked, and within, I think this was by the third year, towards the end of the third year, this was me in Bedfordshire with the Grand Union Canal, and I used to be walking. I got to a stage where I was able to walk eventually 8 miles a day. Every morning, discipline, get up, have breakfast, get dressed, go for a walk. Just like the old days, it was almost like being back in the army, and I'd try and have a march around the canal and then some. And it was good for my motivation, it was good for my self-esteem. And I was starting to develop, you know, a bit more confidence in myself. Again, self-physio. And the challenges for me started to creep back into my life, despite the scarring, despite the physical impairment with the lower limb disability that I mentioned with the bilateral foot drop. Challenges grew. I had an opportunity, I can't believe this was about 2010, I had an opportunity to go and do the London Marathon. I got a place for charity, and I went with an old friend and colleague of mine, and we did the London Marathon together. I couldn't run, because remember the injury, remember the disability. I couldn't physically run. I mean, I could run, but bilateral foot drop, I mean, come on. Are you going to run 26.2 miles? It would be exhausting. You're more likely to risk damaging other parts of your body as well. Okay, so I thought, I can't run, but what can I do? Actually, I can still walk, right? I've still got that ability. I can walk, okay? So I power walked to the best of my ability, and I actually did 3 marathons. But then after the 3rd marathon, I said, God, that hurts. And actually, why do people do this? You know, but it was just a challenge at that era, at that stage of my life, and that stage of my recovery. London Marathon, 26.2 miles. I think the first marathon I managed to get round in about 8.5 hours. Then I got a place in New York, funnily enough, the following year through some contacts. And I thought, you know, if I go to New York, I've got to try and beat London the previous year. I've got to, because that's what I'm all about. I've got to challenge myself and I've got to push it. So I managed to do New York in 7:07. And then the 3rd one, back in London the following year, I gave it my heart and soul. I power walked to the London Marathon in 6 hours and 20 minutes. Not an easy challenge with partially paralyzed feet. My cousin and I, it's my cousin Leon, we made a bit of a pact together over a beer one evening, and that's always dangerous. And we said to each other, okay, we want to do a challenge together, and we actually went down, we flew down, I think it was one of these cheap flights, Ryanair or whatever, and we flew down to Biarritz in the south of France, and we walked across a massive section of the Pyrenees together. Pyrenees, I think it was GR10, the trail, it is about 800 miles, we did about a quarter of it. We realised it was going to take far too much time and far too much money staying in all the guest houses and feeding our hungry bodies. So we decided after about 200 miles that actually we're satisfied with that and we came home again. But we did challenge ourselves. Just a couple of shots for you about the environment. But the amazing memories, great motivation for me going down there. One of my first trips overseas after the Burns accident. Beautiful environment, and it reminded me a lot of, you know, my time with the Army Reserves. It's quite a religious route, incidentally, ladies and gents, also with these old pilgrims. So it felt like it had some, you know, significance for me coming through the life-changing sort of ordeal. I even went to Lourdes en route. We took a bit of a dogleg, and I went to Lourdes, and you know, I was still kind of coming through, and I still had a lot more operations to go, and I think I said a sort of a quiet prayer to myself about, you know, wanting to get the best sort of results possible for my recovery. But it was very inspirational for me going to Lourdes. People go there for all sorts of reasons. Another big challenge moving forward, I got an opportunity to go out to Africa, and I climbed, the majority of the way up Mount Kilimanjaro in Tanzania, in East Africa. And again, was the biggest mountain that I've ever had the privilege and the fortune of being able to climb, certainly in my life. And a very high mountain, it's 19,340 feet, or 5,895 metres, just shy of 6,000 metres. Very tough, very thin air. Fantastic challenge, especially with limited mobility. I put this in because this is obviously near the summit of Kili. The Kili summit is just in the background. Mostly when you see Kili shots, everyone's at the top. But I like this one because it shows the crater rim. So that's the significance of the summit, if you like. But also, from a you know, from the point of view that it's, you know, I have to say, I couldn't have done this without the team. The team for me was, again, good friend, the same gentleman I did London Marathon with that I showed you. And he supported me, he gave me that moral boost, that encouragement all the way. You know, keep going, Jamie, keep going, you can do it, kind of thing. This guy was the guide, the black gentleman in the middle, and he used to support me a lot. I mean, not so, I was quite a good climbing because the foot drop wasn't really too much of an issue, believe it or not, climbing, but I found it really difficult coming down the steep gradient back down the mountain. Okay, I was kind of struggling because I didn't have that shin muscle to sort of break the force, you know, and I'm coming down the mountain, I literally have to rely on this guy. So we were literally, you know, we were sort of arm in arm all the way down because he helped me. As we were, and that was actually when we were coming back down, and we were like that all the way down. I was glued to this guy. He was my sort of life support. And I've got to use the stick as well, because again, it goes back to my mobility. But with the will and with the determination and with the help, with a team effort in this respect, I was able to achieve a dream. And that dream was to try and summit the magnificent Mount Kilimanjaro. Okay, and that is no mean feat, okay? That would have probably been about 5 years post-injury. A personal passion of mine, which I did many years ago, I mentioned it right at the beginning about running, I used to run remote scuba diving expeditions. I actually found that getting back in the water was great because in diving's a passion, you're pretty weightless down there, and you know, your body doesn't require that. You know, the water is very supportive, sorry, and so the body kind of functions quite well. So I found it from a physio kind of recuperation perspective, I found it really beneficial to my sort of health and well-being, as well as a bit of training on the different muscle groups while I was down there. So took great advantage of that, went out to the Red Sea in Egypt, sort of developed myself a little bit more in the water. Also the salt water for my skin was really, really good. Skin was, you know, well, it still is to this day, it's still a bit dry, it's still healing. Surgeons say it takes about 10 years, and I didn't believe them at first, but I understand where they're coming from. Okay, it takes about 10 years, so any opportunity I get to get out into the blue yonder, I really, really enjoy. And in fact, I actually now assist, I'll talk a little bit more about it, but I actually do assist with a function that the charity Help for Heroes have with wounded service personnel. So I personally co-manage the diving expeditions for the wounded, and I have the privilege to be able to take teams out to Malta in June and September. And actually for me, it's self-fulfilling a personal passion as well as sort of passing on a little bit of wisdom there. Sorry, just a couple of shots. Pretty fishes. It just sort of depicts my, you know, what I love about the activity really. So I got to a stage in my recovery when it was kind of, it was all about that self-fulfillment, you know. A couple of years after hospital this was, and I started to push those boundaries, challenging myself. Marathons, mountains, cycle rides, scuba diving, you name it. And I had some great opportunities along the way, and I felt like I'd really come a long way. Okay, but I thought, you know, what's next? I'm not just gonna keep doing these challenges for me for the rest of my life. And the determination to live was there. It was a whole new life, so what next? I thought about other people. I thought, if I can do this, what can I maybe do to help others and maybe inspire other people? Now this gentleman here, I wanted to put this in because he's become a great friend of mine over the years, and his name is Ben Parkinson. He was recently awarded the MBE from Buckingham Palace, and he was in Afghanistan, got blown up. He was in a vehicle which struck a 30-year-old Russian anti-tank mine. He had 38 separate recorded medical diagnosed injuries, 38, including fractured skull, fractured pelvis, broken back in several places. Lost both limbs, as you can see, plus TBI, traumatic brain injury. So he, for me, became my inspiration. Okay, I worked together with him in a charity for a period of time, and we did a lot of work for charity, kind of in combination with each other. And absolute remarkable fella. I talk about will and determination. Well, he had it. You know, if you broke him in half, he would have been like a stick of rock that just said determined. You know, and that is the gentleman that Ben is, and he became an inspiration for me. Also, a former paratrooper, he was an airborne gunner, so he was an artillery parachute member. Okay, but a great inspiration to me, and his will to continue and his will to challenge himself goes on to this day. He's still really, you know, learning to walk, and he's going great guns. Okay, and I've seen him develop over the years, and again, for me, just massive inspiration. That's helped to encourage me also. Ben and I had some nice function, and it was a sort of a great networking opportunity as well for the charity and some of the work that we both tried to do together. I got the opportunity to go to St. James's Palace before a big function, and helped to bridge some connections towards some sporting endeavours that eventually led up to some big things, including the Invictus Games. But here at St. James's Palace, I got to meet Prince Harry for the first time, and I've had the good fortune actually of being able to meet him many times since, and work on some plans for the Wounded Engine 6 since. Another program that I was privy to was a short skiing rehabilitation program. This was an inaugural program to develop a rehabilitation package again for the wounded. So I got invited out onto the first one. I didn't mention it before, but I had, back in the day as an army reservist, I did have the opportunity and qualified as an army or sort of joint forces skiing instructor. So I was able to get back on skis and found that actually, despite the lower limb injury, I still, using that automotive force, i.e. the mountain and the gravity to drive me downhill on skis, with that force, I'm still able to perform because, you know, the memories were there, the technique was still there to a good degree. So I was able to take part in this program. I obviously met Harry's father, jolly nice chap. Sorry, this was just a little one of me in action. And some other little programs that I got involved in. And this was, this would have been in the early days of the work that I do with Help for Heroes, a charity, a large charity, that I went on to do some work, quite a lot of work with. And eventually I've now become a key national ambassador for Help for Heroes. And this was the first program that I did with them in Vancouver, it was. And we got a great invitation to work with some Canadian from the Soldier On project, which is the Health Heroes equivalent in Canada, and also the Wounded Warrior guys in the US. So it was US, it was British, at Health Heroes, US and Canadian all together. And I can't tell you what a fantastic experience that was for me in terms of, you know, the boys being back together. I mean, we're just old injured soldiers at this stage, but we're all back together, and the banter and the camaraderie and the confidence boost that we all received as a result. Not to mention, you know, the physical side of it and the benefits from all that kind of training. We did some biathlon, some skiing and shooting over there. I went on to do a bigger event. It was a more high profile media event for the charity, but what an amazing event in terms of proving what wounded can do. So this was me on RAMP, which stands for Race Across America. You may not have heard of it. It's not as publicised as Tour de France, but they have professional categories and solo categories. And I got selected as part of an 8-man team. As 8 men, we raced across America day and night, and we covered the US from West Coast to East Coast. San Diego on the beach, Oceanside, San Diego, California, right the way across America to Annapolis in Maryland. We finished at the Naval College, and we covered 3,051 miles in 7 days and I think 7 hours. Yeah, there you go. There's a team, there was a sort of glory photo for the team. But it's not just about the time, it's not just to say, wow, look at what I did. This is about the team. Okay, I was just one man in eight, and if you look closely, there's four gentlemen sitting on the floor, or virtually. Now, why are they sat on the floor? They're sat on the floor because they're in adaptive hand cycles. That's how they got across America, those four boys. So we relayed day and night, and we did it in that incredible time. That was an average of 16.5 miles per hour. We had a 17-man support crew, massive team effort. Okay, we couldn't have done it again without the team effort, and that's what I wanted to highlight. Okay, we had a doctor, we had two qualified physios that came with us that were there just treating us at, pretty much every time we came off the bike, we'd get some excruciatingly painful massage, just little things along the way to help us out. And again, lots of medical staff, lots of sort of staff to help out and make the brews and cook a microwave meal in the back of the RV. But effectively, that team helped us, eight men, get across America in that time at that speed that I mentioned. And so, massive achievement by everybody concerned. There's only seven legs between us as well. I'll let you guys do maths on that. So for me, you know, it was all about pushing those boundaries, okay? Setting my goals and setting new aspirations given the new body, okay, that I had to accept, the physical disability and so on, the bilateral foot drop, the partially paralyzed feet, but still having some faith in terms of what I could potentially go on to achieve. And again, I've mentioned it already, but with the right will and the right determination, you can achieve, and you can achieve the most incredible things. And you know, I've tried to foster that in myself. But testimony in terms of the events and some of the images that I've shown you, in terms of the team, etc., what it's all about and what can be done. Aside from the charity work, I've been very fortunate to now go on and work and do a little bit of extra work in the mountains. I work with individuals that have got post-traumatic stress, and I use the mountains as a bit of a therapeutic backdrop and environment to help promote their recovery. I mentioned the diving experts that I run for boys and girls in some cases, wounded, injured and sick in Malta twice a year. And I'm also very privileged to, I work as a contracted expedition leader for the schools market. So I work with some state but private schools mainly, and sorry, international schools as well. I've now run, in the last 3 years, I've run seven international dive expeditions literally all over the world, to Central America, South America, Southeast Asia, and I do, we do trekking in the jungle, in the mountains, in the deserts, we do some acclimatization work, we do community projects, so we do maybe a new paint job in a school, some light reconstruction, build a new classroom, you know, help with the village, with perhaps new buildings in the village, new homes for the locals, plumbing works and things like that. Basic stuff. You don't need to be a trades expert. And I work, if I do need tradesmen, we can employ them. We have some budget to hire some local people. And that's been some marvellous motivation for me. And it's been lovely for me to be able to step back into the world and utilise, if you like, some of the old skills and wisdom there, and give back a little bit to society, as it were. So, ladies and gents, you know, on behalf of New Forest Physiotherapy, I would like to thank you guys for the opportunity to come down and speak. 3 years on. It's been epic for me, these last 8 years. My journey at the beginning was very dark, and And I would like to just touch on that and remind you of that, because it was a life-changing accident. And it took an awful lot for me to come to terms with 60% third-degree burns and physical disability and so on. And but through those dark years and with that teamwork, you know, from the medical staff, and of course, you know, it goes without saying, family, friends, I was able to sort of pull myself out of that darkness, as it were, and strive forward to achieve new heights. And eventually, with the confidence, gaining the confidence from that, as I've sort of touched on, I was therefore able to go out in the world and inspire a few other people along the way, and work with different sort of groups in that respect, including our very own wounded, injured and sick service personnel, and many of whom have been injured in the recent wars of Iraq and Afghanistan. So it's been lovely for me to come sort of full circle in that respect, from having been a serviceman myself to be working with the wounded, and we, you know, together we've achieved rather some lovely things, some great things together. Again, thank you all very much, and thank you for your attention. Cheers.
Tell your friends about it, because Jamie do talk publicly in various different places, so it's good publicity for him. Let your friends know about this as well. The bar is open, the bar staff are here, so I will be going in there, and Jamie, Sam and Duncan will be in there, so ask us any... Sam won't be drinking alcohol, of course, he'll be drinking water. So if you'd like to come in and join us, you can. If you want to ask any questions of Jamie or myself, Sam, Duncan, or any of the physio team, please do. Otherwise, thank you for coming. It's been great having you here.
Thank you.
Post-operative pain management, I had morphine for the operations, and then, funnily enough, when I was recovering, I had a PCA, patient control assembly. I'd be able to press a button on demand and give myself effectively a very controlled, modest dose of morphine, which basically I feel a bit of pain, press the button, and I fall asleep. I wake up 2 hours later, a bit of pain, press the button. So, you know, it's clever how they manage it, it's extremely clever. But no, thanks for the question. Very fortunate, you know, I kind of got to come through the worst of it in that respect.
Jamie, you mentioned the low points, you know, like mentally down. How did you sort of...
Yeah.
I know obviously you're a strong guy and you spoke about that, but
yeah.
There must have been points when you thought, I want to end this.
Yeah, there were real points. You know, I fought you know, valiantly, as it were, for about a year and a half, I'd say. And remember the picture I showed you with the sort of scalp wounds and the back and the shoulder, and it was all sort of open still. And I said that was a year and a half down the road. And I was really struggling around about that time, thinking, you know, kind of in all honesty, I was thinking, Jesus, you know, how long can I go on? How long can I go on fighting? And I almost got tired of fighting at one stage, you know, like I didn't want to be kind of in the ring anymore. I wanted to sort of throw the towel in. And, you know, luckily, you know, I had sort of, you know, friends and family were there for me, and you know, doctors and nurses and physiotherapists were there to sort of, you know, rally around me each day and sort of pull me through it eventually. But it was a slow, that dark period. It went on for several months, I would say. It's a strange thing actually. The 18 months I was fighting, it was kind of, I was dealing with it. And I think it was probably goes back to your first question about the pain when I talked about the medications. So after 18 months, I'm trying to wean myself off the meds a little bit, thinking, you know, I can't be taking this cocktail forever. It's going to destroy me. So I was weaning myself off, but then I was getting a bit depressed because of pain and you know the depression of the condition that my body was in, you know, mentally struggling with it all. And I would say that, you know, I went through another 6 months of life was pretty dark, and I battled through it, and you know, that's when I think I really relied a lot on, as I mentioned, friends, family, and all the medical people around me. So, but after about 2 years, the 2 year mark, the body was kind of healing up. I was kind of really coming off the medications then. The pain was starting to sort of wax away, or rather wane away, that's a better word. So it was starting to leave me, and life got better. It was slow. They talk about, in the medical world, they talk about turning a corner. You know, I hear that a lot, doctors and nurses. Oh, you know, you're going to turn a corner. And I'm like, where's this, like, T-junction? You know, where's this this 90 degree left hand or this 90 degree right hand bend, you know, when you get to the edge of the road? You know, where's the bend? I liken the bend more to the curvature of the earth when you come through burns. It's a long old bend. And you kind of feel like you can't, did you get that? You feel like you can't visualise that. Because you do turn a corner, but it is literally such a slow and sort of drawn out process. And you've got to hang in there. And that's you know, it's like I mentioned, it's an arduous, protracted fight, which you just got to hang in there and be very, very, very patient.
How about the scars? You know, you've burnt all your back. Is your back very scarred and where the, you know,
yeah, it's scarred. I mean, I have visual scars. I mean, you saw that sort of black and white image, you know, that wasn't a sort of a smooth looking sort of body, as it were. You know, my skin is very, it's been left with, you know, significant scarring. And luckily, the skin, I had a sort of fairly good skin type, I would say, that responded quite well to the scarring in the aftermath of the third degree burns. And it has sort of settled down quite nicely. You know, I still kind of, I have to, you know, you take care of yourself, you know, you bathe regularly and have to use moisturisers and so on. And in fact, it was, you know, a lot of the work that I did with the physiotherapist, for example, in the early days, not just about the obvious, you know, the mobility and the kind of, you know, getting that, developing that mobility once again. But a lot of the work they did was massage and oils and moisturisers to help get that suppleness back in the tissue again, and that would, the idea being that would help to foster further and develop further mobility. So yeah, I'm not, unfortunately, you know, you come from an injury like this, you're not gonna, you'll never be quite what you were, and from a personal perspective, that's a side that you have to accept and you have to come to terms with. And I live with it, and you know, I'm happy in the body, and I'm happy in the sort of skin that I'm in now.
You're amazing.
Yeah, go ahead. At
the beginning of your speech, you mentioned people watching you or looking at you, and people turn away or shy away from you. Any time do you feel as if you wanted to shy yourself away from the public, you're not sure your injury?
Sorry, it's the echo in here. My hearing doesn't pick up so well because I lost quite a lot of ear there to snip it off. So I'm not picking up like Dumbo anymore. Sorry, just repeat that for me.
The question is, you mentioned at the start that there were times when kids would mention your injuries.
Yeah.
Was there ever a time where you felt that you wanted to hide those injuries away from the public?
Yeah, absolutely. I would say for a couple of years, I struggled. You know, when I was first, you know, in the hospital, even in the early days, and they were taking me off ward, it was such a culture shock. If you can understand that, to be taken off my ward, I was in an isolated room by myself, you know, akin to a prison cell really, and I was taken off a ward, put me in a wheelchair, and they said, Jamie, the physiotherapist was, we've got to take you down to the gym, you know, where I told you about where those bars were and I had to do some special work again with the physios. And it was a culture shock. I remember them taking me out off the ward in Chelmsford, and they had to wheel me through a more public section, sort of downstairs on the lower floor or whatever. and there was a canteen bit, and of course, you know, the canteen attracts a lot of public, you know, they're buying their sandwiches for lunch and whatnot, cups of tea, and I'm going through this water, and I'm mummified, for want of a better word. I've got bandages from head to toe, you know, you can see a bit of face, but I've got bandages all around here, I've got bandages all around my body and my arms, and you know, I'm a burns victim in the hospital, but they've got to wheel me through this section to get to the gym, where that was at the time. They've probably changed it all now. But that was a culture shock, and I remember thinking, oh my God, you know, I'd seen myself in the mirror, and I thought at the time, this is not good, you know, and I was, you know, obviously had this, you know, became quite self-conscious about it in the beginning. And I remember feeling that real sense of being self-conscious as they're wheeling me through the hospital. And I would like had my baseball cap on over the dressing, like my baseball cap, you know, extend the baseball cap to the maximum, put it over my head, put it down here, you know, and then put a pair of shades on, put my head down. I didn't want to look at people. That was the beginning, you know. And then even a bit later on, I came out of hospital, and I can remember, you know, the early days of going downtown. They said to me in Chelmsford, it's going to be really important when you go home eventually that you go downtown. And I was like, yeah, cool, go downtown. But then the actual reality of actually doing it as a post-Burns victim in the beginning was really tough, really, really tough. And they tried to promote that these days. And actually, let me tell you briefly, just on a kind of a note of interest. But if you turn the clocks back, many, many years, Second World War. Did anybody hear about the guinea pigs? Second World War, they were pilots of the RAF that were burned in accidents, or they were shot down or whatever, and they had to sort of make emergency landings, or indeed they crashed and survived and they were burned. There was a surgeon called Sir Archie Mackindo, a Kiwi guy, New Zealand chap, and he was the surgeon at East Grinstead. And funny enough, I went there for a month, so I learned all about the history for the month that I was there. I was told, and I was able to read bits and pieces about the hospital, and I found out that Archie Mackindo saved, through surgeries and burn surgeries, more than 650 guinea pigs. Now, one of the pioneering things that Archie did, okay, back in the day, and this I think was part of the reason why he got his knighthood, not just for saving lives, but for thinking outside the box in terms of developing the self-esteem and the well-being and confidence of burns victims. So Archie said to the Burns victims, okay, I've taken you to theatre, and I've done this, this, and this for you, and you're reconstructed, and now you're healing on the ward, young man, young pilot, or pilot Evans, or whatever. But you know what, it's going to be really important that you go downtown. And actually, I'm going to make it easier for you. I'm going to give you two chaperones in the form of two nurses, or whatever. And there, those nurses are going to take you downtown, East Grinstead, in Surrey, and they're going to walk you around, and you're going to go to the post office, you're going to go to the bank, you're going to go and buy an ice cream, and then you're going to come back for the afternoon. And that, in its day, had never been done. And in that respect, Archie, who ordered that process for his patients with the help of the nursing staff, was a pioneer in helping to develop the confidence, because he knew that that was a big factor in their recovery. It wasn't just about the physical and getting the reconstruction, but they were going to need to face the world again newborn sort of burns victims. It was born again. I mentioned that already. You feel like you're born again, because it's such an insult to the body. So yeah, there is that process that you go through for the person that gave you that question, and takes time, and then over time, if you keep pushing that, eventually your confidence will start to come out again. Okay.
Good question. Have you written or have you thought of writing a book about your...
Yes, I have, and it's kind of been on the cards for a while. I think I need to stop being quite so busy to sort of take a moment, really. But yeah, it's kind of in the pipeline for me, and it's something that I would like to do. And you know, it's not about a multitude of book sales or whatever. For me, it would be, if I can get that message out to other people, that, you know, again, I finished on that note with the right will, with the right determination, that's kind of lines on the kind of essence of what I'd like to write about, you know, and use my examples to sort of illustrate that really, and the long recovery journey, you know. But thanks.
Yeah, I look forward to seeing
you. Yes, please. Sorry. Did you?
No.
Did I fly?
Yeah.
I did. And I did. I have flown since several times. I've done a bit of work in microlight. I've done a bit of work in light aircraft out of Chichester. I think up towards my sort of neck of the woods, which is Cranfield, is it? Yeah, Cranfield. And but the reality is, one of the reasons why I did actually, I went through those hoops in America was because I did actually consider a career in commercial aviation, and it was a possibility for me. Okay, I was kind of like the right age to potentially make that career move. But the reality is, when I come through this epic injury, which took years, so that set me back years of my life, and the reality was, I'm unlikely to ever ever make it as a commercially qualified pilot because of the lower limb disability. Okay, I also have some damage to the pickup on my hearing, not massive, but it is significant, and I have a little bit of scarring to the corneal tissue, the cornea of the left eye as well, which is in my visual axis. So I'd probably get, you know, the private medical for private flight is probably not a drama, because it's about the same standard as driving a car. But commercial aviation, the medical standards are very high, and for obvious reasons, because you're carrying passengers. So, you know, I've done a bit, but it's also very expensive, and I'd only really be doing it for sort of private recreation now, and, you know, sort of being there and done enough of it.
With the flying, where's the fear?
Say it again, sorry.
Where's the fear of flying?
There was a little bit at first when I got back in the cockpit. One of the reasons why I wanted to go up again was to try and get back in the saddle, as it were, and challenge myself in that respect as well. I didn't want the burns injury from the flight, from what happened in that cockpit in that aircraft, to kind of be my sort of presiding legacy in memory. Did you get that? So I decided that's why it was important for me to fly quite soon afterwards, which is what I did. And I haven't actually flown now for probably a good year, 18 months, in terms of any private recreational flight, just because of the expense. It's very expensive now. So, okay, anybody else? Any final questions?
Why did it catch fire in the first place? Why did it catch fire in the first place?
My personal strong suspicion was that it was never really fully proven in terms of the sort of engineering aspects of why it caught fire. But my personal theory is that it had a slow and progressive oil leak within the manifold system of the engine. Because it wasn't an explosive fire in the air, so therefore it wasn't fuel. Because it would be very explosive on the ground when that main tank went up, it was boom. It was a slow but progressive fire, so I believe the overriding cause there would have been oil. I don't know what ignited that, whether it was heat, whether it was spark, electrical, perhaps malfunction or whatever. I've got no idea. It was what it was, unfortunately. Ladies and gents. Okay, thank you very much.
There were a couple of other points which I also know. The Pilgrim Bandits charity that Jenny supported, there is a rattle box outside, so if you wish to support that, please do. We do have some leaflets out there for Physio Clinic, and I think Duncan and Sam will have some leaflets as well. So don't forget to pick up some of those. And we do have a half price on sports massage just for people here tonight, so if you grab one of those, we can have a reduced price sports massage. So thank you for coming, everyone.
Thank you.
In the bar.